shall try to live up to that. So, I'm going to basically talk about whether we could finance kind of global mega projects using the blockchain. And by global mega projects, I mean things that are basically too big to do using other systems. And big is not a simple question, right? We don't measure projects really by their size, but also by their risk. So small high-risk things, we've got an excellent way of approaching, which is that we go after them using the startup model. You put a bunch of money in, you roll the dice, most of them fail, that's fine, they're small investments, and the wins cover the losses. When you get to really big projects that have very high risks of failure because you're doing something genuinely new and scary, it's much harder to find the money. So if you've got things that are small and high risk, you can get them funded. Large and low risk, you can get them funded. This is basically the infrastructure sector. What do we do about large and high risk? So this is next generation infrastructure. It's Hyperloop, it's SpaceX, it's all of this kind of stuff. And this is not just about how do we finance Elon Musk. There would probably be other people like Elon Musk if we had the ability to finance other projects like the Mars mission. So what I'm going to basically lay out is a sort of, you know, rough approach to how you would build the necessary legal, commercial, technical infrastructure to make it possible to use the blockchain to finance extremely risky, very large-scale infrastructure engineering projects, which the world desperately needs, because that's how you fix your global transport system, it's how you decarbonize the economy, it's how you expand into space and go and get all these, you know, lovely asteroid mining things set up. All of this sort of stuff requires a kind of money that we don't have, which is large and high risk. So, here's the question. We want to go to Mars, how do we pay for it? The estimate cost on this is on the order of $100 billion if you do it small. So if you send a dozen people, it's going to be extremely expensive. If you start talking more about sending a million people, the price drops dramatically. The estimation for Elon Musk is $200,000 a ticket at the scale of a million people sent. But the money to do the initial engineering on that is obviously not going to be cheap. The gap that's created here, right, that gives us this problem getting things going, is best described by Mariana Mazzucato, who wrote The Entrepreneurial State. And basically what she says is that this kind of mega project engineering was done by the superpowers during the Cold War, and when they stopped using these things as kind of national pride projects, the money stopped going in and progress stopped. It's an interesting approach, not everybody agrees with it, but I think it's certainly one very important lens to look at this kind of global innovation crisis from. Right now, we've got this thing, the ICO market. I'm assuming that everybody's heard of this thing. Raise your hand if you have. Yeah. Okay, so the ICO market, in a nutshell, is people who are issuing blockchain tokens. So they're issuing funny little financial instruments, which are poorly legally defined in most cases, and they're selling them directly to members of the public in exchange for cryptocurrency. Something like $800 million a month is going into these things, and in all probability, the SEC is going to basically empty a gallon of bleach into the pool and hope that it'll stop, because the levels of fraud at the bad end of the ICO spectrum are remarkable. On the good end of the ICO spectrum, you have really significant infrastructure projects that are raising kind of $100 million lumps, which give them, you know, 5 years of runtime with a large engineering team to go out and build amazing things. So in some senses, it's the new end of finance. In the other senses, it's kind of an ongoing disaster. Now, the problem with the ICOs is twofold. Firstly, the rate of fraud, which we addressed. Secondly, they're only doing software. There are really no ICOs to speak of that are doing hardware funding. And if you can't fund hardware, you're not really getting anywhere, right? You know, the hardware is really how the world moves at the most fundamental level. Even Google and Amazon, when you look at them really closely, are hardware companies. There is software, but there are also, you know, tens of millions of tons of servers, you know, stuck in boxes all over the world. Here's the problem. When you're going out to the edge, when you're going to the frontier, when you're funding things that have never been done before, how do you know it's not a perpetual motion machine? I must have seen 20 proposals for ICOs, which suggest that they'd like to raise a couple of $100 million to reorganize human society along egalitarian green lines by changing the incentives of the financial structure. I have a strong suspicion that this is impossible, right? But, you know, we don't really have a sociological theory or an economic theory
which can absolutely nail down whether or not one of these things is a perpetual motion machine. It's not like physics, where there's a certain amount of, you know, finality to energy will be conserved. So it's quite hard to diagnose perpetual motion in new technology. Examples of this, the cold fusion thing. Right. Enormous controversy at the time, which is now, I don't know, what was it, 20 years ago, 25 years ago? Was there something weird happening that produced more energy than it consumed inside of the, whatever, palladium in a tube? To this day, there are still, you know, physicists, chemists working on this stuff. Nobody's really sure. I don't think we ever came to a conclusion. There's a lot of that stuff around. You know, if somebody tells you they're going to go and mine asteroids and shows you a spreadsheet, how do you figure out whether or not they're telling you the truth? How do you tell if they're wrong? We have a solution to this, right? Which is basically, these guys stop you doing anything which is too risky, or they only let you do it if accredited investors or similar groups are the ones putting in the money. The problem with this is that the innate conservatism of people who are professional investors working with other people's money is an enormous break on technological progress. Silicon Valley managed to achieve for about two generations, maybe three generations, nerds with money funding nerds. So you've got an intergenerational transmission of expertise and cash, which is what we call the startup economy. And as the startup economy has become increasingly financialized and financial professionals have moved in, the innovation has, to all intents and purposes, stopped. If you think about the rate of innovation that we saw in the 1990s compared to what you see today, that is the difference between nerd money funding nerds and financial money funding nerds. We're just much more willing to take the risk because we've got a much better sense for what is possible. And if we can reinforce that mechanism, you'll see very, very rapid technological change in a lot of critical areas. And if you can't reinforce that mechanism, what you'll see is business as usual and a kind of Japan-style stagnation. So, here is the first radical notion. I'm going to suggest that the current accredited investor mechanisms that we're using are extendable. Right now, accredited investors in most countries are simply defined by your ability to take a loss. And you have enough assets that you can make some bets, and if the bets go wrong, you will not lose your shirt. It's basically intended to set a minimum wealth level for investment. The problem with this is, firstly, these people don't necessarily have the ability to estimate risk well. So they may be able to take losses, but they're not necessarily able to correctly estimate gains. And that does not really help us build an innovation economy, because if all you have is loss-resistant investors, that doesn't necessarily give you any ability to point the money at useful things. The second problem is that it leaves you in a position where somebody who's got, you know, a PhD in computer science and 20 years lecturing at a major university can't put money into the projects that their own graduate students are creating. You'd think that they would be about as technically sophisticated as you could get, but they're still not allowed to put money in because, you know, they just don't have enough assets. And those kinds of problems with targeting the money on the actual innovation front result in general social slowdown. We need innovation desperately. The world is in a terrible condition in a whole range of axes. Most of those problems are the result of previous generations of engineering solutions, which turn out to have unforeseen downsides. And we can't deploy enough financial power to strip out the old systems and replace them with new systems. And that's almost entirely about our ability to steer money. It's not that there is a lack of investable money in the world. It's that we don't have the structures that can put the money on the innovation front. So, this is probably a little outside of our scope today, but it's not just tech, right? Or at least it's not just digital tech. Synthetic biology, VR, AR, AI, all of those are enormous fronts that need as much innovation capital as we can throw at them, and the skills necessary to get each one of those fronts are different. So the astrophysics guys that will tell you about asteroid mining should probably not be the ones who are also invested in synthetic biology, who probably shouldn't be the ones who are invested in AI. What we need is the ability to have specialized pools of expertise that can organize the professional money. And the professional money, if you think about this in a kind of back of the envelope way, a million people making $100,000 a year could probably put $5 billion collectively into investment schemes before they began to have any real impact on their quality of life. So if you think of the technical professionals, there might be 15 or 20 million of people at those levels of income in the professions with the relevant specialized skills. So you're talking about, you know, $10, $20, $30 billion a year that is basically locked up in the pockets of, you know, salary earning tech professionals that can't organize that money to go and fund innovation in their own fields. And this is an enormous global loss. So, technical investor accreditation. What if we could take people and certify that they've got their relevant PhD or their experience, and then we could give them the ability to invest, say, up to 10% or 20% of their salary as if they were accredited investors? And I think it's relatively easy to see how you could organize that. Right? You might not be able to get all of those people certified, because some of them will be people who came up in their field without ever going through the academic route. They're harder to credential. But you can just do the easy cases, percentage of salary, and tie directly to evidence of professional certification. And this is a new class of investors. And to build the infrastructure out to support that new class of investors, we would need to build out very efficient systems, because each investor is only coming in for 10 or 20K a year. So we're talking about enormous seas of sophisticated money seeking opportunities right at the technical frontier. And this, to me, is what the reorganization of the ICO could look like. If we could get enough of the right regulation in place, we could potentially stabilize the ICO field into a mechanism that allows people who are technically sophisticated to put their money directly on the innovation front. And I think that the long-term impact of that would be very, very substantial, but it's going to need a lot of city expertise to prevent the entire thing being a bloodbath of fraud and disorganization. So, with that as a foundation, could we then proceed to ICO and Mars mission? Right? They need probably tens of billions of dollars of working capital to be able to set up the necessary infrastructure in the form of heavy rocket fleets and all the rest of this kind of stuff. They also probably need a bit of help identifying a clear business model for Mars, because it's not really clear what you're going to do once you're up there, other than maybe use it as a staging area to go further into the solar system for things like asteroid mining. We're talking about doing that within 10 years, right? Boots on the ground on another planet, commercially funded. Elon Musk is talking about the early part of the next decade, which is increasingly close. 6 to 8 years is kind of the most likely estimate. How are we going to organize the finance for this? How are we going to make sure that there is fuel in the rocket ships to actually take us to another planet? This stuff is really significant, right? If we get this right, if we manage to become an interstellar species, an interplanetary species, and then eventually an interstellar one, we're going to have things descended from us in 5 million years that will look back and wonder how it was that life made it, not just from the sea to land, but from land to space. We haven't crossed the horizon like this since amphibians, and that's happening in our generation. We kind of ought to be taking this seriously. It's a big deal. And how do we organize our planet's resources to support that project? That's what I think the highest purpose of cryptocurrency is. It's funding the stuff that we need to actually change the course of human history. Because goodness knows the existing machinery is not working. So, then there's this problem. Right? You take these kinds of risks, you've got billions of dollars of working capital involved, suddenly things go wrong, and in most cases, when something goes wrong at that level, you get lawsuits. So how would we handle the legal risk associated with tens of thousands of small investors putting money into these kinds of mega projects? What do you do if it turns out that the entire thing is a con, not for Musk's stuff because you can actually see it, but in some esoteric field like synthetic biology or AI? Does everybody remember the story of the blood testing company that went down recently? Turned out they'd been faking the results by sending them out to other labs and telling everybody they did it on the cheap. And it was in fact costing them huge amounts of money to get their tests from. So that kind of stuff is very, very hard to detect at the time. Once in a while something will slip through, the entire thing then becomes a legal problem. But if you're dealing with tons and tons and tons of small investors who are distributed globally, trying to organize things like class action suits becomes extremely difficult and expensive. And in all probability, the costs of doing the litigation exceed the benefit to the litigants. You just can't recover your assets because it's going to cost you so much in legal fees that you get nothing back at the end of the day. And all of that encourages more fraud. So the suggestion is that you could do this using binding arbitration. You use the smart contract infrastructure that you get from the blockchain to handle the financial arrangements. That will all be relatively cheap and relatively secure and relatively efficient. When something goes wrong, rather than going down the litigation track, you have expedited arbitration procedures which work hand in glove with the smart contract infrastructure to ensure accountability so you can actually recover the assets if you have to. And that sort of an approach where you have new technology and new regulation and new mechanisms for dispute resolution as an integrated package seems like about the minimum standard that you would need to produce a long-term, healthy and stable crypto-financial system. If you do less than that, if you go out with kind of two legs of the tripod, the thing will eventually fall over, and then you'll get very heavyweight regulation, large-scale banning of the instruments, and it'll be a bit like the kind of hard shutdown that you've got in other markets in the past when people were too irresponsible for too long. When small investors start to suffer, that's really when the crackdowns start. So, at this point, we begin to talk about the possibility of setting up basically a synthetic jurisdiction. So if everybody involved in these kinds of investment schemes is tied together by the same arbitration procedures, and they've signed the same contractual paperwork, you get the ability to create a zone which has standards above those of the existing regulatory architectures. You can't break any of the existing regulatory rules, but you can impose standards which are higher than the existing regulatory rules. And you've got the ability to effectively police, because if the value is on a blockchain and is embedded in smart contracts, your arbitrators have the ability to move that value with the authority that is ceded to them by the initial contracts which appoint them as arbitrators. So we do have the possibility of constructing a zone with a better regulated structure than we could get from any of the nation states that is still managed by contract law in the 1958 New York Convention. And those kinds of structures have the potential to give us the kind of extremely fluid investment environment that we need, with relatively limited regulatory changes to enable them, because the vast majority of the heavy lifting is done with contract law and binding arbitration. And that sort of notion, that you could get special kinds of economic zones from this sort of work, has been proven. Right? The thing that we call open source software or free software is an ecosystem which is worth on the order of $200 billion, and it's essentially one of these synthetic jurisdictions. You create an environment which intellectual property law works substantially differently from the general structures that we have for handling intellectual property, because the contracts which are signed to use free and open source software very strongly mandate that the results of the work that you do will also be shared. So you take something from the pool, but you're legally obligated to give something back to the pool, and that pool is now hundreds of billions of dollars. It runs something like 70% of the internet. So we know that this kind of synthetic jurisdiction, jurisdictional engineering, however you want to think about that, we know that the ability to create a bubble in which the rules of trade are different from the default rules of trade using contract law is an enormously generative thing. We've seen systems like that become global infrastructure. This will not be the last time we see that happen. So inside of those kind of systems, you can coordinate, but you can't compel. So in the situation where there's any kind of conflict, you wind up in a position where you don't have all the necessary legal teeth as you would with full nation state law. You can enforce contract, but you have no ability to access, for example, criminal law. So what we're dealing with is zones of voluntary cooperation which run under their own rules. People have to opt into those zones, and the limit of the enforceability of those contracts is the underlying law of the land in which that person resides. So this works quite well for creating new structures in which we build new systems. It doesn't work so well for cleaning up the regulatory messes in old systems. It doesn't work all that well for doing things that the existing architectures do. So, for example, the GNU public license operates as a layer above copyright, but it doesn't change the fundamental rules of copyright. It's a coordination function with enforcement that delegates down a level to the nation state law, but it doesn't give the ability to just make the rules up as you go, unfortunately. Critical limits, right? You just can't get changes made to the underlying legal structure. You can build standards above the current law, but you cannot change the current law, at least not quickly enough. This means that, for example, if you wanted to do things like environmental regulation using these kind of voluntary opt-in systems, it would be extremely difficult to get the worst polluters to sign up to those systems, and as a result, systemic transformation would be very difficult. So we have an architecture here which is quite good at building the things of the future, like the entire open source software pool, but it's quite bad at cleaning up the messes of the past. That disturbs me a little. I don't have a good answer to that problem. We clearly need more efficient global machinery for cleaning up the messes of the past, not just for building the future, but right now, frankly, I'll take what I can get. So, things that are worthwhile. You can protect the blockchain economy with the right underlying legal work. This is really important. It can be done. It requires a ton of effort, but once it's successfully done, we could see something which becomes as standard and as important globally as open source software, which is 70% of the phone market and about 70% or more of the machinery that actually runs the internet. This stuff is quite important. Opt-in blockchains, right? Opt-in law plus blockchains, rather, enormously powerful as a combination. Contract law enforced by smart contract is an incredibly useful and powerful structure. But you're still going to need something that looks like a world government to clean up the messes of the past. Because we can't coordinate the international functions necessary to manage things like climate change without the ability to compel people who have not opted into the system to change their behaviour. So opt-in law will build the future, but it will not clean up or stabilise the past. Now, do you have one more slide? Yes, we do. So I'll say a couple of words briefly about my own project and then wrap up. So Materium is the project that I'm currently running. It's a company based in London, which is building the bridges between London's existing legal and arbitration infrastructure and the blockchain. And this is largely a lot of legwork about bringing technologists and arbitrators into the same room and figuring out how to write smart contracts with paper contracts, which properly integrate in a way that gives you real enforceability for actual value transactions. If you're going to be moving actual assets on the blockchain, we are kind of the people that are making that possible. The Internet Agreements Conference we just did, there will be video up from that, and that includes an awful lot of very interesting insights into the directions that are necessary to fully integrate smart contracts in law. Sweetbridge are using these kind of approaches to do an enormous transformation in the way that credit is issued in global supply chains. And they're talking about the potential to issue literally trillions of dollars of new currency backed by the assets which are currently in the supply chain. And they have a lot of very, very sophisticated thinking around that. I highly recommend taking a look at their work to give you some sense of what whole systems re-engineering of a financial system might look like, using the blockchain to facilitate, but using the underlying legal architectures provided by the existing nation states as the fundamental bedrock of which it's built. And if you want to get in touch, there's my email address. Thank you very much.